George Bidwell was born around the year 1835 in the state of New York. He came from a humble background, with his father sometimes struggling to keep up with the family finances. His younger brother Austin was born 8 years later. Their parents were strict Methodists, meaning that George and Austin didn't get the same freedoms as other children. For example, not being allowed to play on Sundays. From a young age, Bidwell was eager to make his way in life, trying to earn money any way he could. By the time he was 12, he was already supporting the family by selling a variety of objects in a street stand that he had. 2 years later, he had made enough money to start a business with his father, investing in the Grand Rapids, hoping that they would become successful merchants. But 6 years later, due to poor management, the business failed, forcing George to sell precious jewellery in order to pay off his debts. In 1858, he turned himself into an effective marketing agent for a variety of local businesses in New York, especially grocers. At only 23 years old, he earned enough money to support his whole family. That same year, he met a well-off young lady, and not too long after, they got married. He then left his job as an agent in order to find something better paid. All indicated that Bidwell was going up in the world. Problems for Bidwell arose when a furious customer from his previous job informed his employers that he received a letter saying he owed $10, money that he had paid directly to Bidwell. Bidwell's employers, alarmed, believing it was embezzlement, informed the police and had him arrested. The situation was explained to the magistrate, who quickly discharged Bidwell, realizing it was a simple mistake. However, it seriously damaged Bidwell's reputation in New York. He tried to re-establish himself within the business community, but he had no success. Despite his bad luck, Bidwell earned thousands of dollars in 1864 when he invented the steam kettle. With his earnings, he opened up a business in Toronto, but this was also a failure. One afternoon, in a billiard parlor, Bidwell met Frank Kibb, a con man. The two men began to work together and opened a swindling commission house. It was like any other commission house, which sold goods, but the objective was to swindle people out of their money. After having earned a large quantity of money together, Kibb asked Bidwell to leave on a business trip for the good of the company. Hesitantly, Bidwell left. By the time he returned, Kibb had sold all of the stock for $20,000. Bidwell was left with nothing, but he was determined to get his money back. For months, he tracked him down, and eventually he found him, recovering $10,500. Bidwell returned to New York and stumbled upon a sign stating that a partner with $5,000 was wanted. He inquired and met a man who went by the name of Dr. S. Bolivar. It soon became clear to Bidwell that the doctor was trying to swindle him out of his money. After talking for a while, they became friends, and not too long after, partners, opening a swindling commercial house. Business was really good for Bidwell and Bolivar. However, their illegal operation came to an end in 1865 when they were arrested and convicted with fraud. Bidwell was sentenced to 2 years behind bars. During his imprisonment, he had an opportunity to escape during a jailbreak. Too afraid, he stayed in his cell. A total of 5 inmates were involved with the jailbreak. 4 inmates successfully escaped, but one was killed by the guards. Bidwell went on to regret this and was determined to escape. His first attempt was a failure due to a fellow inmate betraying him. Nevertheless, he tried again, and on Christmas Day, he successfully made it out while the guards were distracted celebrating. After escaping prison, he met up with his younger brother, Austin, and two others, George Engel and George McDonald. The three were well experienced in the art of forgery. Austin was only 25, but already had a reputation. Engel prioritized security and kept a low profile. Meanwhile, McDonald, who graduated from Harvard University, had previously been caught and were sent to Sing Sing prison. The group put their forgery skills to good use and managed to make a nice sum of money, which set them up for life in England. In 1872, they left New York and arrived in London. Here, Bidwell started earning big money using forgery, taking advantage of the banking system. His first strategy involved using the letterheads and format of the English banks to create a letter. He then sent these letters to leading European banks, claiming to be a manager of one of the various English banks. With the European banks believing the content of the letters, once he arrived in Bordeaux, and after identifying himself, he was treated with the highest level of respect. He then proceeded to cash in a fake check that he had forged for 50,000 francs and left with his money. He then travelled to Marseille and used the same strategy, posing as an English bank manager, cashing in a fake check. In Marseille, he obtained 62,000 francs. The next day, he went to Lyon and did exactly the same, again obtaining 62,000 francs. After his success in France, he returned to his partners back in London. It seemed like he had found the perfect scam. However, it wasn't long until the banks noticed that it was fraud. Seeing as many European banks were now taking extra precautions, Bidwell left for South America in order to get more money by using forged letters of credit. However, the name of the sub-manager of the bank was not added to the document. This tiny detail was a big mistake, as Bidwell only managed to get £10,000. Ultimately, his fraudulent campaign in Brazil was a failure. Now back in London, him and his younger brother devised an operation which could potentially earn them millions. It started off with Austin creating an account with the Bank of England under the name of Warren, acting as if he owned a car manufacturing business. This was so that nobody questioned the large sums of money going in and out of the account. For months, Bidwell McDonald had been depositing authentic bills into the account. They then began buying bills of exchange and forged acceptances. Austin then set up another account with the Continental Bank using the name of Haunton. While forging the acceptances, they quickly discovered that the Bank of England didn't take much notice if the signature on the acceptances were real or fake. Seeing how bank officials didn't check this small detail, the group decided to take advantage of the situation. As there was only three of them at this point, Austin believed more people were needed to pull off the scam. He called a friend of his from New York called Noyes, who came to London, serving as an extra pair of hands. He didn't ask how the process worked or its details. He trusted Austin and followed whatever instructions he gave him without question. With the group complete, on the 21st of January 1873, the huge fraud operation began. With the acceptances forged, Austin went to the bank and each day he presented a forged acceptance. The acceptance meant that Warren's account was owed a certain sum of money and that this debtor accepted to pay it. The trick was that the bank paid the money straight into Warren's account, and the bank had to wait 90 days to reclaim the money from Warren's debtor. The debtors, of course, didn't exist, as the acceptances were forgeries. The Bank of England saw Warren as a rich man, running a successful business, so they had no need to inquire. Furthermore, the acceptances came from people who were also in strong financial positions, so from their perspective, everything was in order. The money that was received under the Warren account then made checks in favour of the Haunton account. As soon as the money came into Haunton's account, it was drawn out. The group exchanged this money at the Threadneedle Branch Bank of London for gold, bonds, and cash. This was done on a daily basis for months. The group accumulated a fortune using this strategy. It's estimated that in today's money, it's equivalent to $10 million. The group believed that the first forged acceptance would soon be discovered. They made sure to be ready to escape when the time came. Meanwhile, the Bank of England had no idea what was going on behind the scenes, believing that Warren's account was completely normal. what seemed to be a perfectly devised plan came crashing down on them due to a simple human error. Two of the forged acceptances that they had created didn't have a date on it. The Bank of England believed it was an error, so they sent the bills of exchange to the Rothschilds, asking them to correct this mistake, as they had supposedly signed the acceptance. Evidently, the Rothschilds refused, and immediately the Bank of England realized it was a forgery. A few days later, while Noyes was making a deposit to the Horton account, he was recognized by a branch manager and was arrested. The group heard of the arrest and knew that the bank would soon be on their tails. They quickly divided up all the money and burned the evidence. The group fled from London to various locations around the world, hoping they would make it out of England safely. MacDonald's flea attempt was short-lived. He managed to make it out of England, but as soon as he stepped off his steamship in New York Harbour, he was arrested. His gold, cash, and bonds were seized, and he was immediately sent back to England. George Bidwell fled to Ireland. During his time there, he saw a photo of himself in the paper, offering a large compensation for his arrest. This shocked him. The police had surveillance covering all means of transport, and they knew he was in Ireland. Bidwell was well aware that he was being traced, so he went to Edinburgh in Scotland, thinking he would be safe. However, on the 3rd of April, 1873, only 3 weeks after his arrival, he was arrested. Unfortunately for Bidwell, a local news dealer informed the police of an American man who frequently bought the paper. Later, the police found his lodging, and after talking to the landlady, they knew that it was Bidwell. Not long after, he was located, arrested, and taken to London. With Noyes, MacDonald, and Bidwell in London, under police custody, the only person left to be caught was Austin. It took the police around 3 months to track Austin down. He was finally caught in La Havana, Cuba, and was sent back to London on the 28th of May. With all the men back in England, the trial finally began in August 1873. Despite being very capable criminals who had devised a very good plan, they didn't cover up their tracks. The investigators from Pinkerton's, a detective agency, made use of all the clues left behind by the group and had created a solid case to prove their guilt. The trial lasted 8 days, with over 90 witnesses giving their testimony, many of which proved the crimes that the group had committed. After having heard all the testimonies, it took the jury only 15 minutes to come to the conclusion that they were guilty. Austin and George Bidwell, MacDonald and Noyes all received life sentences. Bidwell couldn't stand living in prison. He wanted to die. Eventually, he summoned up the courage and cut his own throat, but he survived and eventually went on to recover. In 1887, after having served 14 years behind bars, he was let out of prison due to poor health. He returned to America and wrote a book about his life. In 1899, his younger brother died, and Bidwell gave a lecture to try and cover the costs for his burial. Bidwell had nothing at this point. He was poorly nourished, living in poverty, and had to beg to survive. On the 25th of March, 1899, he finally passed away from natural causes. It just goes to show how law and order catches up to almost everyone. A man who had become extremely wealthy from using forgeries to trick banks ended up with nothing. Thank you everyone for watching the video. Please like and subscribe, and if you enjoyed it, please share, as it does really help out the channel. I will see you guys in the next Forgotten Life. Thank you.